for you.
Two.
Yep. And then I love the Lord's presence.
Yeah, that's good. Right. All right. Well, thanks for being at convention. How far did you have to travel?
Altogether 7 hours.
7 hours. That's not too bad.
Not too bad. Yeah.
Good to see you.
Good to see you.
Good evening. It's good to have you at the Interchurch Holiness Convention, and my name is Jamison Plank.
My name's Scott Loper, and I am from Lebanon, Pennsylvania, and it's a joy to be here at this Gatlinburg Convention. Are you happy to be here, Jamison?
It is so good to be here, and I am from the state of Iowa, and we are both pastors. And
I just held a revival at your church.
Yes, you did. I had Scott and Caitlin Loper in Mount Pleasant, Iowa. And they held a revival meeting for us. They sang, and he did a great job preaching God's word. And as young people, it is just so encouraging to come here to the Interchurch Holiness Convention.
It is.
And to see God's people, and to know that you can live a life in God's will.
Right.
And it's not a boring life,
and
it, Scott?
And it's fun serving Jesus, isn't it?
It's a lot of fun.
And Brother Durst loves to talk about that in the time of discovery. And speaking of time of discovery, we have the time of discovery shirt that we gave out this year. We're both on the committee, and isn't that a nice looking shirt?
Yeah, so every year, you know, we have a shirt on the back side. We have all the denominations, the churches, the organizations that help sponsor the IHC, and we love our young people.
We do.
And we are young men, but every year it seems like we get a year older.
That is profound. And we do. And I just want to publicly say that I want to thank our sponsors who sponsored Time of Discovery. I called many of them trying to get them to sponsor us and get their name on the shirt. And there's going to be lots
of really,
different ways
well,
to give.
People are willing to give.
They are. And speaking of giving, it's been a crazy year, honestly.
Like record giving. IHC has never cost more in its existence since 1952.
Unbelievable.
And God has already provided the need for this convention. And tonight we're going to take up a Bible college offering.
That's exciting.
A love offering to the Bible colleges.
Awesome.
And obviously it takes money all year long. The IHC 24/7. And
new ministry that's happening.
Yes, and, Building for Keeps.
Building for Keeps. If you did not tune into this afternoon's service, there's a new ministry that will be happening, and that is the Building for Keeps.
I believe it's an encouraging thing when our dads finally listen to us.
I know. It's just about time they listen to something that we have to say.
You know,
and they finally did this year.
Yeah,
and
you know, my father, he
has a motto, doesn't he?
He does have a motto. It can be done. And most of the time when we pitch an idea or Scott and I are talking
it cannot
with our fathers,
be done is what they say.
It cannot be done.
But
we reminded them that it can be done.
It can.
And I believe that God really helped us in the Building for Keeps service. And it was encouraging to hear the testimonies of how, you know, it's easy to start believing that everybody as maybe had a bad background or didn't serve the Lord growing up, but so many of our people are just like us, you know, and they at a young age they decided to serve the Lord and go God's way, and God's been faithful.
Yes.
And I just believe that it can be done in this generation and into the future, and
there's
never been a better day to serve Jesus.
There has, and something happened in that service that has never happened before.
What
and
that
was, we never took an offering. We did not take an offering in the Building for Keep service. And in the history of IHC, there has not been a service where there hasn't been an offering taken.
So it really wasn't intentional.
It,
We were in my dad's office. We were typing out the schedule, getting everything printed out, and we didn't realize that every service had an offering at IHC.
Well, that's correct. And I mean, Jameson asked myself. He said, "Do we need an offering?" And I simply said, "No, we don't," because I personally have faith that money will come in. I do.
That's right, and I believe that. That they listened to the young whippersnappers.
They did.
And
you know what
even
happened?
If it wasn't as intentional as we want it to,
right,
everybody to think, we had the faith.
We did.
We did not have an offering this afternoon. And my dad said possibly for the first time since 1952.
Unbelievable.
IH convention did not have an offering. And
we found out right before that service that the entire budget
had been taken
IHC
care of.
Had been taken care of. And so we didn't need an offering.
And so I want to say thank you to you.
Yes.
There are so many people that tune in from all over the world.
Unbelievable.
And IHconvention.com, you give throughout the year. You're praying for the convention. And it means so much.
And we need your continued support.
Yes, we do. And even in this offering tonight.
Right.
For our Bible colleges, you know, in Gatlinburg, Tennessee, there's a lot of cost for them to drive here, to bring the buses, the young people, and the hotels.
Yes.
And so,
and we may be dumb, but prices are going up. Inflation is all around us. And we might have to talk about what the next service is, God and Country Rally. It's starting at 6:00. If you want, please stay online, tune into that service. But you know, we need to be praying for our country, and the cost is rising. There's chaos all around us, but there is something constant and steady about IHC.
Amen. You know, it's my entire life I've never missed an IH convention. In 2020 it was a little abnormal because of COVID.
That's
the whole
true.
World kind of turned upside down. The cyber convention happened, and really the live stream ministry took off.
It did.
And many of you maybe joined for the first time in 2020. And we say thank you for supporting us through that difficult time. And then obviously because of COVID, God moved us here to Gatlinburg, Tennessee. And
what do you like about Gatlinburg?
Gatlinburg, Tennessee. Well, you know, for me, it's just so much to do. It's a friendly place for our families. It's a safe place.
Right.
It's there's a lot of attractions. It's almost a place where you can come and get spiritual renewal at kind of like a camp meeting, a convention like you see behind us, but also you can stay a couple days after or come a couple days
before
IHC and have a family vacation.
Yeah. I personally love Gatlinburg, Tennessee. This is a great spot, and I am so happy that we chose this spot here in Gatlinburg.
Yeah, it's great state.
It is a great state. But I do miss a little bit of Dayton.
I don't.
You don't?
I don't.
I miss the bleachers. And I know there are a lot of people who miss the bleachers. I'm just telling you, I miss it. I like to people watch. And when you're here at this convention, and if you have not come,
you know,
you need to come.
Where we're sitting right now in the upper level of the Gatlinburg Convention Center is almost like the bleachers.
It is.
Turn around with me, Scott.
I know.
You know, if you sit here long enough and you close your eyes and just listen to the mass choir and orchestra practice, would think that you're in the bleachers.
You do. That's correct.
And it makes you feel at home. But I don't like Dayton.
Okay.
There's nothing about that. I know you're from Cincinnati.
Yes.
But there's nothing about Dayton that I miss.
Well,
Gatlinburg, Tennessee has opened the door wide open, and the future of IHC is awesome here.
Oh, it's so
you know,
bright.
This is not a rundown building. If you've never attended here in Gatlinburg, you've got to come. Young families,
necessity.
Young people.
Yes.
You know, the biggest thing for me is that it's not people just driving over after work, but the families are coming.
And they're staying all day.
They're staying all week.
Yeah.
All week.
Right.
Right here and attending every single service throughout the day.
That is correct. And also, it's more affordable than I think you might realize. IHC gets some pretty good rates with the hotels that are surrounding this convention center. And I think you really need to contact the IHC office and talk to them about how you can get a room reservation even now for next year, 2025. And I'm looking forward to it already.
You know, Scott, I had a gentleman from our church there in Mount Pleasant, Iowa that came Tuesday. And he did not have a room. He looked up on his phone and found a room less than a quarter of a mile from this convention center for $48 a night.
Really?
And so you can like Dayton, but we like Gatlinburg and we want you to come. Scott might have his convention in Dayton next year, but the IH convention is going to be held here.
Well, and I'm for that. I really am. But so, tonight is special.
It's an awesome night.
This is one of the best nights
closing
of
service.
IHC.
Closing service of the IHC.
6 p.m. is the God and Country Rally, the Roll Call of the States by Leonard Sankey, and that is a highlight.
And it's so good
of
to have
convention.
It is so good to have Brother Sankey.
Oh, I mean, I think of Brother Sankey. He's one of my heroes, and we need to be praying for him. But man, it's so good to have him here this year, and to see him doing the Roll Call of the States again. I'm so excited for that.
And I know that maybe you're not able to be here this year, but when Brother Sankey calls your state, I hope that you
yell and scream.
I hope you yell and scream. And put in the comments on social media or in YouTube and tell us where you're from. Email us. We'd love to hear it. Okay, so then after the God and Country Rally, Scott, what's going to happen?
At 6:30 p.m. is the closing challenge, and Reverend Kenny Stetler from Indianapolis, Indiana, is going to be coming, and he's going to be sharing with us in that service. And the convention youth choir is going to be singing.
The highlight of the convention.
It is. I mean, to see enormous amount of kids standing up there on that stage.
Right.
Young people, that's the next generation.
And like I mentioned here in Gatlinburg, truly the average age of convention, I believe, is much lower. Because these are family, these are young people and children. In the Building for Keeps service,
right,
we had the kids choir sing, and here tonight we're gonna have the youth choir sing, and then after that, the Bible College choir.
Yes, the convention mass choir and orchestra, and that's gonna be conducted by Don Quails. He's from Allegheny Wesleyan College, and he will be directing the mass choir, and that's also a highlight of IHC. People love that, and I do too.
It is a great thing, and we're trusting the Lord to help us in this service. And thank you for joining us live here in Gatlinburg Convention Center. Obviously, the service is about to start, but we're praying that God meets with us here in the final service. And we really want you to come. If you've never been to the International IHC, where people come from all over the world, we want you here.
Right.
And so whether you're tuning in from Papua New Guinea, whether you're tuning in from Mexico or one of the states here in the United States, we want you here. And I hope that you make it a priority in your life next year.
Yes, please, please come. And if you're not here right now, what I would encourage you to do is like and share the post that you're watching right now. Like it and share it so that we can have as many people around the world
tuning in. You know, my dad says it's just like sharing a gospel tract.
It truly is.
And you know, we don't listen to our fathers very much, but I think you should. And I think you should like it, you should share it. And thank you so much for joining us here at the IHC. And there is a great group of people. If you're believing Satan that the IHC is dead, it's not, it's alive. And we're so happy to have you here.
Thank you so much.
This is IHC 24/7. Your prayers and support are helping us in our mission to spread the message of holiness around the world. It is our joy to bring you inspiring messages, uplifting music, and the Word of God every day. We hope you will continue to join us as we journey together in faith and hope. Thank you for making IHC 24/7 a part of your day.
Hey everybody, Governor Bill Lee here. Welcome to the Interchurch Holiness Convention. We are honored to have you in Tennessee. You have been the hands and feet of Jesus in your local communities And I'm grateful for your work and the work of your churches to share the gospel and make families and communities across the nation stronger. Maria and I pray that this time of fellowship will encourage you, and we pray God's richest blessings over you in the years to come.
Enjoy Gatlinburg IHC all over again with IHC 2024 Replay. Tune into IHC 24/7 on April 16th, 17 and 18, when we will be rebroadcasting IHC Gatlinburg 2024. It will all start at 1:30 on Tuesday afternoon and continue through Thursday evening, with each service replaying at the same time it happened during the convention. Tell a friend, and be sure to tune in for IHC 2024 Replay.
Find yourself a seat. It's filling up very quickly. This is going to be a wonderful service, and you don't want to miss any of it. Enjoying the music of Brother RB and Kenny over here. And so find yourself a seat quickly. We'll begin in just a couple of moments. Isn't it wonderful to be still in the land of the free and the home of the brave? If you're happy to be an American today, say amen. Amen. And if you're from another country and visiting, are you glad you're here in Gatlinburg, Tennessee, United States of America? Say amen. Amen. Well, it's a little lighter, but there's a few less than Americans here. We appreciate all of you being here tonight. We want you to join into this service with all of your heart. Give it everything you have. Brother Barry Whitaker is coming to lead us in singing. Let's stand together, please, and sing for the glory of God.
Song number 236, and we're going to sing verse 1 and 4. Let's sing it from our hearts this evening.
My country, tis a sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing.
We want to first recognize our international guests. We have a long list of people who have been in this convention. Whether they're here tonight or not, I do not know. But you're welcome to holler and cheer for your country. IHC is truly an international event and becoming more and more so as we go to so many international destinations. It has been a privilege to have Dr. Langat here from Kenya. He is a leader in the African Gospel Church, representing 2,500 churches here at IHC for the very first time. My brother, would you stand up wherever you are? Give him a round of applause. What an honor to have him here. And he has invited IHC to Kenya today. Praise the Lord for the invitation. And then, what an honor, I'm hoping he is here in the service tonight, Jose Kumisera, a leader in the Peru Pilgrim Church, the very first time that he is here, and his church has also invited IHC to Peru for the very first convention in January. If you're here, brother, would you stand up? Clap for him anyway. He may be, I'm not sure. He's right over here, right here. Praise God. Amen. So happy to have you here. Lord bless you. We've had representatives here from the Turks and Caicos Islands. I need to hear you if you're here. All right. We've had representatives here from the Philippines, from Papua New Guinea, from Canada, from Northern Ireland, from Ghana, from Haiti, from Mexico, from Honduras, from the Bahamas, from Guatemala, from Bolivia, from China, and from Nigeria. All right, any other countries? I'm sorry. Well, praise God. Brother Sankey, Jamaica? Brother Sankey? We are so thrilled that you're here another year. We're expecting at least 10 more. If we run into any problems, you just get a bigger tank and keep coming. Give Brother Sankey a round of applause. We love this man. Thank God. We love you, Brother Sankey. Amen.
Thank you.
No one can do the roll call of the states like Leonard Sankey. So if he can't make it, I think it's going to be off. But let's go for it, Brother Sankey. It'd be nice if all 50 states are here tonight.
It would be nice. All right. Thank you. Wow. How excited I am. This is a great, great convention. And it's so nice to hear about all the international outreach of the convention. I'm so thrilled and so delighted. I'm not much of one for fun when it has to do with church. But it doesn't mean that funny things don't happen. After the wonderful service this morning, I went to the room. Janet has not been feeling well, so she was there. And I found her crying from the effect of the service. And so we chatted a little bit. And she said, "You heard from Norman." And I said, "Well, what did Norman have to say?" "Well, Norman wrote to you and said, 'Leonard, you're looking good, except for those things hanging out of your nose.'" So I wrote back and I said, "If you can discover decor for oxygen tubing, I would appreciate it very, very much." Another funny thing, my son told me of something that happened maybe 30 years ago, so you can know how long we have been trying to do this thing with the states. And he said, a young man came to GBS, wasn't from our churches, wasn't accustomed to us, and so he came to GBS, sat in the classes, went to revivals, and all the things that happen on a GBS or on a God's Bible School campus. And then Dayton Convention came up. And so he went to the Dayton Convention, and on Friday, after the convention ended on Thursday night,
Mark said to him, whatever his name was, said, what did you think of the convention up in Dayton? Well, he said, it was all right. He said, that guy who stands up and calls the stakes, that seems worldly to me. So you can't win even when you're innocent. So let's take a little time here and go through the states. Those of you who have been here many, many years know that I just take them more or less alphabetically. I'll make a couple of detours on a couple of the states where typically we have more representatives. But basically, I'm going to start with Alabama, and hopefully I'm going to end with Wyoming. And if you're here and represent one of those states, even our Bible college kids, if they're here from different states, I invite them to participate. And but I'm going to have to hear you, all right? When I call your state, holler. I was going to say whistle, but that may not be good. But holler, let me know that you're here. All right, are you ready? All right. I just wanted to make sure there were people here. All right, here we go. We're going to start with Alabama, work our way down. Here we go. Ready? Alabama. Wow. They really did come. All right, going to go far north to Alaska. Arizona. I was looking for that. All right, how about Arkansas? All right, California. Colorado. Mark said that guy who thought these states were worldly is because sometimes I add in the nicknames of the states. And he thought I was talking about sports teams. And I thought later, I said, I know so little about sports teams. I said, I can tell you more about the 1948 Cleveland Indians than I can about any state or any team that's going on now. But anyhow, I thought it was world because maybe I said Ohio Buckeyes or something like that. All right, we're ready to go. Connecticut, Delaware, Florida. All right, how about the Peach State? Georgia, Aloha, Hawaii, Idaho. That's pretty weak. How about Illinois? Iowa. Good deal, wow. Kansas. How about the bluegrass state, Kentucky? Louisiana. That sounded Cajun to me. Incidentally, those of you who are online, when I call your state, if you want to holler at your monitor, go right ahead. We won't hear you, but you can vent. All right, Maine, Maryland, Massachusetts. All right, well, that's the main thing. Massachusetts. All right, here we go. Spartans, Wolverines, Michigan. Minnesota. Mississippi. Missouri. All right, good deal. The Show Me State. Montana. Big Sky Country. All right, Nebraska, Nevada, New Hampshire, New Jersey, New Mexico, the land of enchantment. The Empire State, New York. All right. How about the Tar Heel State, North Carolina? All right, very good, good, good. North Dakota. Oklahoma. All right, well, sooner late than never. Oregon. Rhode Island. South Carolina. South Dakota. All right, I want to take a special time here to call out our host state. And you from Tennessee, you can shout, but the rest of us want to give you a round of applause and thank you for hosting the 73rd Annual IH Convention, the state of Tennessee. All right. Very, very good. The volunteer state. The great state of Texas. That's a small group, but it sounded authentic. Utah. I think they call that the Beehive State, maybe. Vermont. Virginia. A couple thousand miles from here, I see in my mind at least three people huddled around a computer, and the wife is saying to the daughter, "Look, there's Papa." So out across the miles to the state of Washington, and in particular Federal Way, we're sending our greetings. Anybody here from Washington? All right. West Virginia. Wisconsin. Wyoming. All right. So let's deal here with the state of the Buckeyes. Where is Ohio represented? Good deal. Wow. Those guys handle the big guns back here. Very, very good. How about the Keystone State, Pennsylvania? All right. Very, very good. Now, Mark, have I missed somebody?
Yeah.
You're going keeping track of it. I actually have a copy of this for Mark, but I didn't give it to him because I thought he might interrupt me. We're so glad for all of you that are here tonight. Welcome, and let's enjoy the rest of this service tonight and what God has for us. RB, what are you doing? Yeah, I know, I'm coming. I'm not among the hurrying Hoosiers. Let's take the great state of Indiana. All right, very, very good. All right, thank you.
Brother Going, to pray a special prayer on our nation in this crucial year and at this crucial time, that God will save America.
Let's live together in prayer.
Our loving Heavenly Father, we're so thankful tonight that we have a prayer hearing and a prayer answering God. We're so thankful tonight for the privilege of living in America, the greatest land that ever was. But we need your help tonight. We realize, Lord, that we're facing some issues today that we've never faced before. We know that you are very much aware of all that's happening. And I pray that somehow you look down upon our country once again and give us divine help, help that we need beyond ourselves. Lord, you have said in your word that if your people who are called by your name will humble themselves and pray and seek your face, that you would hear from heaven and you would forgive their sin, you would heal their land. And we need a healing tonight. I pray that somehow you'll move upon those who would lead us, our president, our vice president, every senator and every congressman and the Supreme Court and every judge and every citizen. Help us, oh God, we pray, to somehow call upon you on their behalf. We know that the Holy Spirit who gripped our own hearts and brought us to the foot of the cross to surrender ourselves to you can also speak to those and direct their thoughts. I pray that somehow tonight you will intervene. Help every church, we pray. Help us as a whole, as people, Lord, to do all we can to influence our nation. I pray you'll help us to influence our communities and help people to turn to thee, for we know that you are the answer to the cry of our heart. I pray tonight, Lord, you would just speak to each one of us and show us what you would have us to do. May we honor you and follow in your footsteps. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
Thank you. You may be seated. How did you like the Star Spangled Banner by Blake Cassidy? Didn't he do a good job? Blake has traveled on behalf of IHC as a willing but, you know, forced servant, because his mom and dad have taken him to conventions all around the USA from east to west, north to south. I have pictures of Blake handing out bulletins at the door of churches all over the place. And I was just looking at one the other day in Wyoming. He's just a little kid, and we just used him to haul stuff in the church and out of the church and hand flyers out. And I thought it was time that we honored Blake by allowing him to sing the Star Spangled Banner for this night. Not Blake, Ashton. We did this for Blake too, and Blake gets all the credit. He don't need any more credit. That's Ashton. Ashton Cassidy, and we appreciate the Cassidy kids, even Chloe. I just want to make a couple of announcements before we take a small break, before we go into the main service at 6:30. I just have to say thank you. Thank you from the bottom of my heart for everyone who works so very hard to make this convention possible. We don't, on purpose, just get up here and list a bunch of names. It's the people that you see or don't see behind the scenes making it possible, working very, very hard. As the convention has grown, so has the workload. Also, as the convention has grown, so has the financial load. Never has a convention cost as much as it did this year. But you have given and given and given, and before the afternoon service, we realized we had reached our goal that we had set for this convention, $200,000, the largest budget in our history, not because we are overspending or looking for new ways to spend, but because the convention is simply growing in scope and ministry and just the costs of life here in this convention center. This is one of the largest conventions in this convention center, and everything takes finances and help, and we just thank everybody so very much. Thank you for your giving. Thank you most of all for your prayer support for IHC all year long. This is not just 3 days. This ministry is all year, all around the nation and now around the world. We ask for an interest in your prayers through the ministry of IHC 24/7, a new ministry that was dedicated to the Lord in this convention. We invite you to listen, tune in, and it'll help you perhaps to keep up a little more with what we're doing and to pray for us. As you see us going into a convention, We'd love for your church to pray for us, just as you pray for missionaries, I hope you do. Just as you pray for other ministries, our Bible colleges, I hope you do. I hope you'll put IHC on your prayer list, and we would be so very grateful. We need help after this service, after the final service. See Steve Cassidy, Nathan Weaver, they'll be right up here. If you want to take a fern home with you, they're $100 or less each, mostly less. Please come back next year, 2025. Write these dates down, April 8th through 10. If Jesus tarries, we'll be back here at Gatlinburg, Tennessee. How many have seen a bear yet this week? Come back next year. I think you'll see. You'll see one for sure. All right? Help sponsor a family to come. Help your pastor and family to come. If you need hotel reservations, call us and we'll help you. And we just want all of you to come. Bring somebody with you. Last year, one of our schools, probably unknowingly, it was not Hobe Sound Bible College, I can assure you, because they are from the South, but it was one of our northern Bible colleges that in the state of Tennessee, in Gatlinburg, Tennessee, chose to play the Battle Hymn of the Republic. If you know your history, it was the wrong song in the wrong state. And as soon as it was begun, we had some folks from Tennessee get up and march out in protest. You think that's ridiculous, but it's serious. And two of our very generous donors came to convention this year and told Brother Loper that they had lost their checkbooks since that song was played. And so to make amends one more time, and I really felt like Brother Loper should sing the words, but he wasn't sure if he knew the song. But we're going to have a verse or so of Dixie just for these disenfranchised people here tonight. I want you to stand, though. Stand for this one. And then when he's done with that, I want you to find somebody nearby that you can greet and welcome and be ready in 5 minutes for the main service.
as you find yourself getting back to your seats, let's sing an old faithful of IHC back from its inception. I don't care what church you belong to, just as long as for Calvary you stand, just as long as your heart beats with my heart, you're my brother, so give me your hand. And I don't care what church you belong to, just as long as for Calvary you stand, just as long as your heart beats with my heart, you're my sister, so give me your hand. And I don't care what church you belong to, just as long as for Calvary you stand, just as long as your heart beats with my heart, is what unites us no matter. And we've got to keep that as the focus of our attention forever. It unifies us. And it is the cross of Jesus Christ for which we stand. Praise the Lord. 186, let's sing this song at Calvary. As we sing this song tonight, I want you to notice the progression of testimony that Brother Newell gives to us. He talks about a time in his life when he didn't know about God and didn't care. But in the second verse, he talks about a time when he came to an understanding of what he was missing. And fear, it came into his life by the word, I trembled at the law I'd spurned. Fear is a good motivator, but it will never keep us. For you see, after he found out and his heart trembled, he then became aware of the love. And he says, now I've given to Jesus everything. Now I gladly own him as my king. And then in that last verse, as he testified, he just was overwhelmed with his grace. Oh, the love that drew salvation's plan. Oh, the grace that brought it down to man. Oh, the mighty gulf that God did span at Calvary. Let's sing it together tonight.
Years I spent in vanity and pride.
I As we turn over to page number 69, the youth choir is making their way to the platform as we sing this song. Endeavoring to get the mind of the Lord tonight. I felt drawn to this song. It's been several years since we've sung it here. I love this old song. I trust that you will sing it with all of your heart. Give it all you've got tonight as we honor our blessed Savior who gave his life for us. Praise his name. Hallelujah for the cross. The
Well, praise the Lord. I'll tell you what blessed me the most was Andrew Durst down here cheering them on. If you want to know why we chose Andrew Durst to direct the time of discovery, that's the reason. Amen. I love to see somebody behind our young people, pushing them forward to spiritual things. And we're behind them, aren't they? Aren't we? Thank God. Well, let's take an offering. We took a break this afternoon. That just felt so terrible. So let's take an offering tonight. We need you to give generously. We appreciate all of our Bible colleges. We do have five of them that participate with the Gatlinburg Convention again this year. And of those five, we would like to take an offering tonight. And if you give $5, it'll be a dollar to each. If you give $5,000, it'll be $1,000 to each. That's how we're going to do the offering tonight. Unless specifically marked some other direction, even the money that comes in online, unless specifically some other direction, if it comes in during this service, we're going to put it towards our Bible colleges and their expenses to come to Gatlinburg. All of their young people bless us so much, and we deeply appreciate it. The mass orchestra from the various colleges will be doing the offertory. Josh Smith, we appreciate the young men and the young people who help us in the place of prayer, and we're asking him to come and pray a prayer of faith that God will make this offering as big as it needs to be to meet the need.
Let's pray. God, thank you for being here tonight with us. Please help us as we take this offering. Please bless the gift and the giver. Help us to be cheerful givers, Lord, and help us in every aspect of the service to praise you. Amen.
Our conductor will be here momentarily. He got stuck in a traffic jam of young people. Overdorf, give us a little bit just for a moment. Go ahead, play. As we're waiting on Brother Quails, he's coming momentarily.
All that thrills my soul is Jesus. He is more than life to me. He's the fairest. Amen? Praise God. Thank you, orchestra, for that beautiful, beautiful offertory tonight. And I echo what Brother Plank said. Thank you for your giving in this convention. I will say one more thing about our trade-off of anthems. There's a beautiful picture, an early photograph, one of the earliest, I guess. And it's of veterans from the North and the South in Arlington shaking hands over a hedge. Have you seen that? And that's what we're going to do. We're going to shake hands and put that behind us. Amen? Amen. Good. I'm glad a few of you agree with that. God has been here, and I've sensed His help and His presence in many of the services, and He has anointed the speakers, anointed the singers, anointed the various aspects of our time here, and I'm grateful for it. He's answered prayer again, and we rejoice in that. And tonight, we are going to be favored with a special by President Adam Buckler. He's going to sing for us. After he's done singing, we're going to receive a message from Brother Kenny Stettler. And I'm looking forward to what the Lord has for us tonight. I know that He wants to speak to our hearts. I know some of us are thinking about it, a trip home. But if you'll just pause for a moment and allow the Holy Spirit to speak to you, I believe He will. And I'm anticipating that in my life, and I know that you are as well. Let's allow the Holy Spirit to minister through His servants tonight as they come and do so.
Shining in me. Will you empty me of every selfish thing that might hinder my sweet walk with Thee? Shine down upon me and fill me through and through in every way, Lord. Let me be more like You. Lord, will You empty me of every selfish thing that might hinder my sweet walk with Thee? Shine down upon me and fill me through and through in every way, Lord. Let me be more like You. When Your love light is shining within me, there's no hiding its wonderful glow. My family and children, my neighbors and all my friends, when I'm filled with Jesus, all others will know. Lord, will You empty me of every selfish thing that would hinder my sweet walk with Thee? shine down upon me and fill me through and through in every way, Lord, that may be more like you. Lord, will you empty me of every selfish thing that would hinder my sweet walk with thee? Shine down upon me and fill me through and through in every way, Lord. Let me be more like you. Shine down upon me, Lord, and fill me through and through. In every way, Lord, I want to be more like you. In every way, Lord, let me be more like you.
Praise God. Isn't that the prayer of your heart tonight? Empty me, Lord, so I can be more like you. You know, I've found that I've never taken anything out of my life to make more room for God, but what he did not come and fill that void with something so much greater and so much better. And I hope that's the prayer of your heart tonight. Praise God. Well, it's an honor to speak to you today. This is my 32nd year of life. I'm 31. I'm in my 32nd year of life. And this is my 32nd IHC to attend. And it's a privilege to be able to speak to you today. IHC has always been the highlight of my year. And now we are headed back to the jobs and responsibilities and problems and, in some cases, places of ministry of life. I remember thinking when I was a teenager that the Friday after IHC was just the worst day of the year. You know, it was the real Black Friday. Just the worst day of the year. I felt like Peter on the Mount of Transfiguration. Lord, if we could just build three tents and stay here, you know. I just wanted to stay here. But we've had a wonderful week together, haven't we? It's been a wonderful convention, a wonderful time of rekindling and renewal and revival. And I'll be honest with you, I needed IHC this year. I needed it. I came in tired, and I came in needing to sense God's presence, and I came in needing the fellowship of God's people, and I haven't been disappointed. And I'm so thankful to all of the preachers who have been faithful to us this week. I'm so thankful to all of the singers who have sang with anointing and with power. Thank you for being faithful to the Holy Spirit and ministering to us today. But now it's time for us to go back. Now it's time for us to go back to the needs and responsibilities and, yes, even the problems of life. And as I sought God for what I felt like he wanted me to, what message he wanted me to send you home with tonight, I felt drawn to Matthew chapter 16. And so if you have your Bibles, I'd like you to turn there with me. Matthew chapter 16, Jesus is speaking to his disciples, and he's talking to disciples who are getting ready to be sent out. He knows, though they don't, he knows that it will not be long before they are leaving him and being sent out, charged with the responsibility to go out and advance God's kingdom and build God's cause. And so he's speaking to them and trying to prepare them, tell them what they need to know. In fact, it's not long after this conversation that Jesus makes his last trip down into Jerusalem, and the events of Passion Week take place. And so he begins to speak with them and tell them several things that I'd like to notice tonight. He tells them the foundation of the church. You know, if we're going to go out of here and build what God wants us to build, we need to understand the foundation of the church.
He tells them about the future of the church. You know, if we're going to build what God wants us to build, if we're going to be what God wants us to be in our life, we need to know about what God expects the future of the church to look like. So I want us to look at these things. You know, future and foundation, those two words are very closely connected. I bought a house some time ago. And the first question I wanted to know when I was looking at that house is, what's the foundation like? Could you tell me about the foundation? Could you have the inspector look at the foundation? I wanted to know what the foundation was like. And the reason for that, we all clearly understand. We don't have to explain why that's the case. Foundations predict futures. If you have a good foundation, you're going to have a good future. If you have a foundation that's fractured and flawed and has problems, the future is unclear. And so when Jesus begins to tell us about the foundation of the church and the future of the church, we ought to listen closely. And so as you've turned there, I'd like us to read in Matthew chapter 16, beginning with verse 13 tonight. When Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, "Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" And they said, "Some say thou art John the Baptist. Some say Elias, others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." And he said unto them, "But whom do ye say that I am?" That's not a bad question. It's a question Jesus asks of all of us. Simon Peter, the bold one, he says, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus congratulates him. He says, "Blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but the Father, my Father, which is in heaven. And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it." Jesus here gives us the foundation of the church. He tells us there is a rock, a solid foundation stone upon which this church will be built. Upon this rock, Jesus says, I will build my church. And so the question is, if foundations truly do produce and predict futures, we ought to be asking this question: what was the foundation stone that Jesus is talking about? Because it sounds like here that Jesus is telling Peter that Peter will be the foundation stone of the church. Isn't that kind of what it sounds like here? Can we agree on that much? And you know, for many years, that was the interpretation of this verse. Many Roman Catholics still believe that. You may wonder, how in the world do Roman Catholics place so much stock in a guy with a pointy hat on? How in the world can they believe in things like papal infallibility, that when the Pope is sitting and teaching, he cannot make mistakes? It's because they believe in apostolic succession. They believe that the foundation stone of the church is a man. But truthfully, the truth is just about the opposite. They believe that the foundation stone of the church, it was founded upon Peter, and then Peter laid his hands on Linus, and then the church was built on Linus. And then Linus laid his hands on Anacletus, the third pope of the church, and then the church was built on somebody named Anacletus. I'm not sure what his parents were thinking, but that's what he was named. And then Anacletus laid his hands on Clement. And then the church was built on Clement because the foundation stone of the church was a man. That's what they believe. But the truth is really just about the opposite. And I believe that because of this. When Jesus was saying this verse, saying these words, he did something somewhat peculiar. He used two different words for the word rock. He said, "Peter, you are a rock, and on this rock I will build my church." He said, "Peter, you are a Petros, and on this Petros I will build my church." And those words are similar, but they are not identical. Petros, the word referring to Peter, carries the meaning of a small rock, a movable rock, a pebble, if you will. But Petros carries the meaning of a large, immovable foundation stone. Jesus is saying, "Peter, you're just a pebble, but you have stumbled onto the rock upon which my church will be built. Peter, when you declared that I am Lord of all, you stumbled upon the rock upon which the church will be founded. You know, I don't have a greater revelation to bring you tonight other than Jesus Christ is the foundation stone upon which the church is built. He is the immovable rock. The grand design for this church is founded upon Christ. You can build your life on that. It does not matter what happens in our world. It does not matter what happens in the political scene this November. It doesn't matter what happens in the economic outlook, whether it goes up, down, or sideways. There is a rock, a foundation stone, an immovable stone that cannot be shattered that our church is founded upon. Oh, we exist to declare this truth to a world in need of a sure foundation stone. There is a rock that you can build your life upon. We exist to tell people enslaved by sin, oh, sin is not the rightful master of you. There's a rock you can build your life on. You can found your life on something solid. We exist to tell a world that is rocking and reeling, caught up in constant chaos. Oh, there is a fixed point in a swirling universe. You can build your life on something solid. We exist to tell families that are breaking apart all around us. We just had a family in our bus route. The mother got in an altercation with her neighbor. We picked this girl up for years. The neighbor came over with a gun and shot her in front of her children. This is happening all around us. Oh, we've got to tell them there is a rock you can build your life on. You don't have to live this way. You can be different. There's a rock you can found your life on. Jesus is Lord of all. You can build your life upon the rock. You know, it used to be that drugs did not get out of our cities all that much and make their way into the countryside. It used to be if you lived out in the country, you didn't have to deal with a lot of the craziness that we in the city have to deal with. But that's not the truth anymore. Drugs have come to your next door no matter where you live in the United States. People are caught up in this. They can't get out. They feel hopeless. Oh, what an opportunity to tell them, you don't have to be bound up in sin. You don't have to be bound up by the habits that have you wrapped up. You can found your life on something solid. You can build your life on a rock. You know, I believe a lot of theological questions come back to this question. Is Christ Lord or not? Is He a rock or not? You know, people have asked, can we live above sin? Of course, we have contended for many, many years. Yes, you can. But you can ask 10 theologians and get 10 different answers. And I believe the answer comes back to the question, is Christ Lord or isn't He? Is He Lord or not? Oh, if we're going to be faithful to our foundation stone, we have to trumpet out the message. Yes, you can live above sin. Yes, you can live above the ways you used to live. Yes, it's possible. Jesus is Lord. You don't have to be tied up in those things. Jesus is the foundation stone of the church. We can't lose sight of our foundation stone. Jesus said, on this rock, on this declaration that I am Lord, I will build my church. Now we've moved away from foundation to future because we see Jesus is using future tense here. He's telling us something that's going to happen. Jesus has laid a foundation and now he's expressing what he intends to do with this foundation. Wouldn't you have loved to hear Jesus say these words, I will build my church. Oh, I would have loved to have heard him say it. In part because emphasis changes meaning. You know that, right? Emphasis changes meaning. That's why I don't like to do any important conversations over text, because emphasis changes meaning. You can't hear how I said it and I can't hear how you said it. Emphasis changes meaning. It doesn't take too long to get from let's eat grandma to let's eat grandma. I'm not real comfortable with that. Emphasis changes meaning. Maybe I can explain to you what I mean. My good friend Andrew Durst is down here, and we're real good friends. If I'd have known him when I got married, he'd have been in my wedding, I tell you. I love Andrew Durst. You weren't in my wedding, though, Andrew. Calm down. And Andrew, if I said to you, these words, and I'm not saying this seriously. I didn't say you were ugly. Emphasis changes meaning. I could say, I didn't say you were ugly. But Brother Cassidy, I heard him say something along those lines. I did. I didn't say you were ugly, but boy, I sure thought it. My goodness. I didn't say you were ugly, but Andrew, your brother Charlie, what happened there? My goodness, that poor fella. I didn't say you were ugly, but I did have a few choice words about your intelligence. I'm not sure about that. You know, emphasis changes meaning. Wouldn't you have loved to hear Jesus say the words, I will build my church? Maybe he said it like this. Maybe he said, I will build my church. I will build it. If he said it like that, he was telling us, it's my place. It's my place. Did you know it's his place to build his church? It's his place to. It's not your job. It's not my job. It's his place to build his church. Oh, that takes a weight off my shoulders. All I'm called to is faithfulness. All I'm called to is obedience. He said, I will build my church. Perhaps he said it like this. I will build my church. If he said it like that, he was telling us, it's my promise. It's my promise. You know, can I be honest with you? Sometimes I get real discouraged. Most of the time it's late at night. My wife just has to put me to bed and hope I wake up better. Sometimes I fret and I worry about things. I worry about things happening in the church. Lord, what are you going to do about this? Lord, what's this all coming to? God, what's going to happen here? Can I be real honest with you? Sometimes I fret and worry about myself. I feel inadequate to do what God's called me to do. Sometimes I feel like, God, why did you ask me to do this? God, why have you called me into the ministry? I'm not even sure I can do this. You know, you get done preaching twice on a Sunday and you've taught Sunday school class and you've sung with the Sunday school kids and you've dealt with a problem and you get home and you say, Lord, maybe you ought to make me a bread truck driver or something. I'm not sure this is exactly what I should be doing. It's real easy to get discouraged, but then I remember his promise. Then I remember he said, I will build my church. Then I remember he said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Then he said, I will be with you to the end of the age. Oh, I remember his promise that he said, I will build my church. I'm a part of the greatest organization this world has ever seen. I get to be a part of his church. And so I'm going to keep on working and I'm going to keep on praying and I'm going to keep on obeying and I'm going to keep on preaching and I'm going to keep singing to the top of my lung because Christ said, I will build my church. Praise God, it's his promise. Maybe he said it like this, I will build my church. I will build it. If he said it like that, he was telling us, it's my project. It's my project. Are we surprised he's a builder? He's the son of a carpenter. It's my project. It's my project. He came to build this church. He came to do something great in this world through the church. Oh, I love all of our parachurch organizations. I love our denominations and I love our camp meetings and I love our Bible call. I love the IH convention. I love every single one. But friend, the only thing he promised to build was the church. He didn't promise to build my thing. He didn't promise to build your thing, but he did promise to build the church. He said, I will build my church. Perhaps he said it like this. I will build my church. My church. It's his possession. It's his possession. You ever wonder if Christ sometimes looks over the balcony of heaven and he sees all the activity and all the frenetic planning and all the running about and all the things done in his name? And do you ever wonder if he just says, oh, don't forget. This is my church. It's mine. It is my church. Don't forget. This is, I suffered without the gate. I shed my own blood to purchase this church. It's my church. It's my church. Perhaps he said it like this. I will build my church. My church. It's what he's came to do. It is his purpose. It is his purpose. That's what he's here to do. He is here to build a lighthouse. He is here to build a soul-saving station. He's here to build a place where lives can be changed and destinies can be altered and people can be forever different because they walked into a church. It's his purpose. It's his purpose. Jesus said, I will build it, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. You know, when I was young, I remember hearing this verse. And I remember hearing people talk about it, and I thought it meant this. I thought it meant that Satan and his demons were going to be mean, real mean. And they were gonna attack us all the time. And it's going to be real bad. And we were going to struggle real bad. And we were going to be backed up against the pearly gates. And they'd slip open. And we'd slip inside. And they'd shut behind us. And we'd be breathing heavy. And we would say, oh, good. You know, our hair wouldn't be singed. And our clothes wouldn't smell of smoke. But it was close. You know what I mean? Oh, good. Oh, at least he didn't win. Oh, at least he didn't prevail. But you know what? I think I was wrong. I don't think that's the right interpretation of this verse. You know why? There's a hole in my logic. Gates don't do any attacking. Gates are defensive structures. Gates are meant to stop an advancing force. Jesus said, not even the gates of hell will be able to stop you. The church will push back the forces of darkness, and darkness will not be able to comprehend it. We will conquer by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. All hell's going to tremble before the church of God. Satan will be trying to keep souls from us, but we'll be snatching them back from him, right and left. Jesus said, not even the gates of hell will be able to prevail against you. Oh, that's a future I want to be a part of. That's an institution worth giving your life to, friend. You ought to give everything to the church of God because it's gonna win. I don't know what your end time theology is, but here's mine. We're gonna win. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Not even the gates of hell will prevail. Not even the gates of hell will prevail. Praise God forever. Praise God. That's our future. Jesus wants you to understand, as you go back to your corner, friend, your future involves triumph. Your future involves victory. Praise God. Praise God. And you know, we could stop there, and I probably should. I have not looked at the time. I may be going over. It's a bit of a family tradition now. But I can't stop there. I can't stop there because Jesus didn't stop there. We've seen the foundation. It's Jesus. He's the rock, friend. Don't forget it. He's the cornerstone. We've seen the future. It's bright. You're going to want to be a part of this thing. The church is headed towards victory. But Scripture, in fact, this very passage goes on to tell us one more thing. And I've got to notice it before I let you go. The Scripture goes on to tell us the formula. You know, if you've ever built a house, you know that between laying the foundation and the realization of those future plans, there's a lot of living that's in between those two things. There's a lot of blood, sweat, and tears. There's a lot of hard work. Christ gives us the formula that will take us from a firm foundation to the beautiful, bright future he's foretold. And he tells us in two separate conversations. We've seen one of them already. Jesus and Peter talking. Peter gives a brash, bold answer, and he gets congratulated for it. Jesus says, flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto you. And I can kind of see Peter sort of kicking the dust and sticking his thumbs behind his lapels and saying, you hear that, boys?
flesh and blood hath not revealed this to me, but his Father, which is in heaven. But the very next conversation, right here, in the following verses, these conversations are right beside one another. The very next conversation, Peter gives a brash answer, and he's rebuked. Jesus says, "Get thee behind me, Satan, for you do not savor the things of God, but the things that be of man." I want us to see it quickly. Verse 21, just right down from our passage here. Verse 21, "From that time forth, Jesus began to show his disciples how that he must go unto Jerusalem and suffer many things and be killed and be raised again the third day." Lord, you were talking about victory, right? Triumph, if I remember correctly. What's this whole thing about being killed? You mean like die, Lord? I thought you said we were going to triumph. I thought you predicted victory, Lord. Verse 22, Peter takes him, rebukes him, saying, "Be it far from thee, Lord. This shall not be unto thee." You know, anybody can be happy hearing about triumph. Anybody can be happy hearing about victory. And yet, you know, we don't always like how God goes about victory. Jesus says, "Get thee behind me, Satan, thou art an offense unto me, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but the things that be of man." You know, God's goal is triumph. God's goal is victory, but God's method is sacrifice. God's purpose is the gates of hell not prevailing, but God's pathway to this future is picking up your cross and laying down your life. Here's Christ's formula for victory. Verses 24 and 25. "Then said Jesus unto his disciples, If any man will come unto me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow after me. For whosoever will save his life will lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake will find it." This is the formula for the future victory of your life and your family and this church. Come, take up your cross and lay down your life. So here's my call to you. Do you want to be a part of a triumphant church? Oh, I do. Sign me up. More than words can say, I want to be a part of a church that is triumphing. The only way is following Jesus to Calvary. Do you want to see the forces of hell driven back? Do you want to see darkness receding? Oh, I do. More than words can say, the only way is following our Savior to the cross. Pick up your cross. Lay down your life. Do you want deliverance from the sin that has had you bound? Follow in the footsteps of the one who defeated sin, my friend. It's the only way. This is the formula. This is the pathway. This is how you get from the foundation Christ has laid to the future Christ has promised us. We must follow the formula. Pick up the cross and lay down our lives. May God help us to do it. Praise God.
Thank you, Brother Stetler, for that beautiful message tonight. Praise God. May we be willing to take up that cross and follow him tonight. The Mass Choir is making their way onto the stage, and as they do, would you stand with me one more time and turn to page number 203 as we sing, "I Have Settled the Question Forever." Praise God. I remember when the Lord spoke to my soul, I could feel the heavy burden from me roll. When he spoke the gracious word, "Wilt thou be old?" Then I settled the question forever. Oh, I settled the question, hallelujah. I will never turn back from the narrow way. I go through it, Jesus, hallelujah, till I reach the face of glory some sweet day. Thank you. You may be seated as the Mass choir comes to sing.
It truly does change lives. Hallelujah. Well, trying to meet the theme of the convention, sin, man's problems, holds God's solution. This next song says he bled and died to take away not sins, but sin, which includes that. He paid the full price. Our God sent his son for us. I'm so thankful for our great God tonight. Praise his name.
Oh,
been so good to our Bible colleges and Christian schools. He's been so good to the IAC and the Dinner Convention. And he's been so good to me. He's been so good to you. He's honored tonight. This is the quietest world we'll ever live in. Praise God. We need to get practiced up. Thank the Lord. Amen. You're not ready. The altars are still here and you can pray. But I'll tell you why it's good to be ready, because this could be the last convention before Jesus comes back. And I intend by his grace to be part of that convention in the sky. Praise God. Just wonderful to be a Christian tonight. Is everybody done rejoicing and shouting and praising God? Don't go home defeated. Thank God. I appreciate our young people tonight. Thank the Lord. We love them. We appreciate them. We're pulling for them. Thank God. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast and immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Now, the God of hope, fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that we may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Ghost. Amen and amen. Till Jesus comes, until we meet again in 2025. And God bless you, all of you.